So let's open the Word of God this morning in the book of John, chapter 2. We're going to be reading from verse 1 onwards, and I'm using the NIV version, the New International Version. You might have a different translation, but we'll just follow. It'll also be on the screen. And so if you got it, just if you got your Bibles, and I always encourage our peoples, our family, to bring your Bibles, because you might have a different translation, and it's good to also follow, not also just use the screen, but even your own Bible that you can underline and look through and make notes of. So if you got it there, you just say amen. Okay, John 2 from verse 1 onwards. It says, on the third day, somebody say third day. A wedding took place at Cana in Galilee. Jesus' mother was there, and Jesus and his disciples had also been invited to the wedding. When the wine was gone, Jesus' mother said to him, they have no more wine. Woman, why do you involve me? Jesus replied, my hour has not yet come. His mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Nearby stood six stone jars, water jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, now draw some out of them and take it to the master of the banquet. They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then the cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now. Let us pray as we prepare our hearts to receive what the Lord has for each and every one of us. Heavenly Father, Almighty God and King, we come before you and we thank you, Lord God, for just opening up your word. And Lord, we are privileged and honored, Lord God, to have the ability and the know-how, in a sense, of knowing what it is that you are speaking to us through your word and through your scripture. And reveal more and more of yourself to us this morning, Lord God. Your nuggets, your treasures. I pray, oh God, that you would just open hearts and minds, that you would cut through the marrow and the bone. And Lord, as always, your servant will decrease and you will increase. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. So although the series is called New Wine, I felt it fitting to actually every Sunday to have a title for a particular Sunday in the series of New Wine that we're going. And I was, thinking about it, working through it, and praying about it, and even myself, for example, discussing about where I'm going with this, this morning, and then it just popped out there. Yes, it popped out there about the title for this morning that I want to discuss with you, and the title is Taste and See. Taste and See. When I read or hear the words third day, it easily moves my mind of another important third day. One in which Jesus hinted to Nathanael would be rapidly approaching. Jesus told them in John 1:50 that they would see greater things, and according to 1 Corinthians 15, there would be nothing greater than Jesus would rise from the dead on the third day. Can I teach this morning? Can I teach this morning? So on the third day, a wedding took place. Okay, so now we understand the importance of the third day. Because Jesus even spoke about the third day, already was saying what's going to happen about his life. And he said to Nathanael about, this is going to be something greater. You saw the miracles now, but even see something greater that's going to happen. And the greatest miracle that happened was the resurrection of Jesus. Can I tell you, no water that turned into wine is as great as the resurrection of Jesus. And so John didn't leave the detail out saying the third day. I believe John, the author of John, he actually mentioned third day for a reason. And it's important for us when we read the Bible, the Word of God, not to miss it out, to shortcut it. Trust the process, remember? So I believe with all my heart that, the author left it in there for a specific reason, third day. And although many people tend to class this particular passage in the Bible to reason for drinking wine, because a lot of people, I know you don't, But a lot of people, when they talk about drinking, and especially drinking wine, they're like, yeah, but even Jesus didn't water into wine. And then they use scripture about, it's okay for me to drink because Jesus turned water into wine. And if Jesus didn't want me to drink, he wouldn't have turned water into wine. And my answer to that was, is I didn't realize you were also at the wedding. Because he did it at that specific moment only. It just means you're very old. But as much as a lot of people tend to just, you know, have that as the primary reason for the scripture about allowing for us to drink and for allowing us to party and do all of these things, I believe this passage is something more incredible, something more powerful in store for us. Because the wedding at Cana actually speaks about the resurrected Christ. And I'll explain it as one, because you gave me permission to teach this morning. And I'll explain this to you. I'll teach you about this. Because Cana was already pointing to the resurrection of our Savior Jesus. It might have been classed as the place of Jesus' first miracle, which is debatable. And I'll say this here. But as the first few words states, and you're going to repeat it after me, the third day speaks of the greatest miracle, which is the resurrected Jesus. Now, I remember a few years ago, I don't want to say how much years back, because otherwise I'll give my age away. And let's leave it there. But I remember a few years ago, my sister bought my niece a bicycle. I'm not going to tell you which shop or retailer she bought it, because I don't want to shame them and blame them. But she bought this, and it came in this flat pack. You know, like you have to assemble it. It didn't come like it. The bicycle is there. And so she thought it best to phone her brother and ask to assemble the bicycle. So myself and Roxanne, we were married by then already. So we got there, and I see the box, and I'm like, I see the picture, nice pink bicycle. It's got those little tassels on the side. It's got training wheels. It looks so cool. And I thought to myself, this looks easy. So I opened a box, and there was like 1,000 and so pieces. And you know, okay, not all men. Please don't put your hand up. We take the diagram, we look at it, like, I can do this. And so I started assembling the bike. Roxanne was just there for moral support. So got going. They even give you a little, like they gave you a little screwdriver thingy, I think, like a spanner thingy. And then you're like tightening things up. And let me just say, a few hours into this, a lot of frustration moments, I realized that something is wrong. Not only the fact that I had more spare parts than what is actually on the bike. You know, like all men, they're like, when the wife says, why is there so many parts left? No, they gave us extra. And so I realized, yo, something is wrong here. Because I got to the place where I got to the most important part where my knees have to sit on the actual bicycle, the seat. And I'm like trying to, and I was like, but this thing is loose, man. Why is this thing moving so much? I know bicycles are supposed to, able to move around, but yo, this is like loose. And now I'm starting to doubt myself now. And I'm looking for every part and there's no part for this to connect this seat. And I'm looking, I'm getting frustrated. And at that moment, and maybe men, you might not, acknowledge it, but I can acknowledge it. I'm vulnerable in that way. I felt very inadequate. Because all I could think was like, my niece is going to need to ride this bike eventually. But I can't even assemble this bike. Like, what is my niece going to think about? Her uncle can't even assemble a bike. A kiddie's bike. Really? And then I have my moral support behind me. And I'm thinking, what must Roxanne think about me? I can't even assemble a kiddie's bike. And then I thought about my sister. She was like, I wasted a phone call phoning my brother to assemble a bike because I would have been better off just doing it myself. Long story short, Roxanne says to me, just check in the box again and look and look. And we checked the box, eventually I did open the diagram. And then I realized that there's something in the picture that is not with me. Can you put a picture up there? This thing. Now, it looks big on the screen, but I promise you it's about this size. Now, it's called a seat clamp. That's a clamp where you clamp the actual seat to the frame of the bicycle. I didn't have that. The box was incomplete. But I was spending hours and hours looking for the seat clamp. Everywhere. Looking for the seat clamp, feeling inferior, feeling incomplete, feeling that I'm inadequate. Only because the supplier did not supply the seat clamp. So we had to go back and tell them that the box is incomplete. In case you're wondering, my niece did get a bike. But I didn't assemble it the second time around. I don't know why. So maybe that's sometimes how we feel at times in that situation when we get frustrated, we're trying to do things, and then it hits us that we feel inadequate, that we can't do things. That what are people going to think about us? What are people going to think about me? And maybe, just maybe, we feel just like that box, that there's some incomplete parts missing. Some parts in our life that are missing that makes us incomplete. I don't know if you ever felt like that. Maybe it was those moments before your wedding, you were thinking, my goodness, what am I getting myself into? Am I up to this? Am I going to be a good husband or a good wife? Maybe it wasn't the moments when you heard that you were going to be a parent and you're saying to yourself, I literally have no idea what am I supposed to do right now. So I want to ask you, do you feel inadequate today in some way? Perhaps much like the box, we see the parts in the bicycle that are missing, but we feel like we cannot complete it. Is there incomplete parts in our lives? Is there incompleteness in your life? Are you missing something that your heart is just desiring for that will make you complete? But at this moment in time, you feel inadequate and incomplete. And if so, this passage that we are studying this morning, I pray God will use this as a balm of the gospel to your soul. Because we see Jesus walking into this incomplete situation and nothing stays the same. Because new wine speaks about new life. And when new life comes, nothing stays the same. We read in verse 3, the center of this conflict, where the real inadequacy happens, when the mother of Jesus says to her son, they have no more wine. Talk about lacking something. Talk about incompleteness, inadequacy. There's a party, and you might say, well, maybe they just need to shut down the party. Party is wedding feast. Let me just explain this. In ancient times, they didn't like nowadays, it was just for, you know, a wedding for a day. It wasn't just maybe a wedding for 2 days. It wasn't just a wedding for 3 days. Remember third day? And so oftentimes when we read this passage, we say, we read third day and we think that the wedding is only 3 days. No. It was just the third day of the wedding. In ancient times, in Hebrew times, a wedding can actually go as long as 7 days. That's why when on the third day, the wine ran out, there was problems. Because people are looking around. They're like, yo, what is happening here? Now, let me explain also in those times in Hebrew culture, in ancient times, the groom was responsible for providing the wine at the wedding. Now, a lot of, you know, authors, a lot of, you know, theologians have studied and said that maybe Joseph was like poor because that's why the wine ran out on the third day instead of going through the 7 days. They really cannot say per se. But here's the problem with this whole situation about you cannot just go and shut down the party. I cannot imagine Joseph going to the people, guys, just letting you know, I know we're supposed to go for 7 days, but on the third day, we decided we're going to do a fast. Just letting you know, we're not going to do any more wine. We're going to be sober for now. Here's the problem with that also. He cannot do that. Because even in that culture, believe it or not, it was a shame culture. Because a lot of people used to talk about it. If you did something wrong, people will tell the whole village about what you did wrong. If you were inadequate, if you were incomplete, believe it or not, a lot of people will hear about it. If you did something wrong, the whole village will know about it. And so Joseph couldn't just go up and say that I'm doing this, I'm doing that, but unfortunately we cannot do this anymore. Because guess what? They will go to Hebrew Facebook. And they will go there and they will complain. And they will say, did you hear about Joseph at the wedding? The wine ran out. How dare they? They invited me to this wedding. I traveled from Egypt. I came all the way. And this is what is happening. No more wine. This fool. How dare he run out of wine? But you see, Jesus here, and he told his mother that there is a shortage of wine here. That his mother is telling him there's a shortage of wine here. It's a big deal. There's shame involved. There's incompleteness. There's inadequacies here involved. The groom is going to be exposed and the bride's family is going to be embarrassed. And Jesus, we read in verse 4, says to his mom, woman, why do you involve me? My hour has not yet come. Now, let's just quickly unpack this. Can I teach this morning? Because here's the thing. When we read woman, you know, we talk about, you know, communication, sometimes how our body language, how we speak, how we do things. Now, oftentimes, I try to put myself in that place. How did Jesus speak to his mom? Like, sometimes we think when we say woman, like, woman, how dare you? But here's the important part. Again, when we read the Word of God, we have to actually take it and research and find out what is actually meaning. Because, again, we're talking about Greek translation. And in Greek translation, there was no actual English word for what it actually was Jesus meaning in this particular passage. You know, the only thing close to this that they say is lady. Now, can I just say, I can't see Jesus saying to his mother, hey, lady. But here's something more incredible about that word woman. Because Jesus says this at this wedding, but the only other time he says this is when he was on the cross. When he says woman. Go read it for yourself. When he tells these disciples also that they have to look after his mom. But he addresses her as woman. So here's the thing. The same care, the same love that Jesus had on the cross for his mom to say woman and use the word woman, I can honestly say it's the same care and the same love he addresses when he says to his mom, woman. So it wasn't a way of disrespecting his mom. It was just the way it was said that makes the difference. But he carries on. My hour has not yet come. My hour is associated with the hour of his arrest, trial, and crucifixion. Until that hour comes, no one has the ability to arrest him. John 7:30 says, at this they tried to seize him, but no one laid a hand on him because his time had not yet come. John 8:20 says, he spoke these words while teaching in the temple area near the place where the offering were put. Yet no one seized him because his time had not yet come. And I believe it that when Jesus is saying, women, my hour has not yet come, Jesus is referring to the time when he will be arrested and be led to the cross. Because I believe of all my might that Jesus ultimately knew if this goes public about him being the Messiah, being the Savior, people will be out there to get him. Because remember, this is the first time that Jesus is really going out, really going with his disciples. And so he knows that this is a close circle of people. So he can't perform this miracle because it's really not going to go too out, too far, too wide. Because remember, every time when he did a miracle, he would sometimes tell the people that he healed, don't tell them. Because his hour has not yet come. Because he knew that when he goes into ministry, when he goes into this time of when everybody's going to see that he is the King, that he is the Savior, there are going to be people that's not going to like this. And they want to go out and kill him. And that's why he says to his mother, my hour has not yet come. But I loved what Jesus' mother does, because she understands that maybe my son, he says this, but I'm still going to trust him. I'm still going to believe that everything he does is for the good of the people. And so let's keep reading to John 2 verse 5, where it says, his mother said to the servants, do whatever he tells you. Leave it to the mother of Jesus to set us straight. Do whatever he tells you to do. That's something that we struggle with at times. To have trust and to surrender. Because that's ultimately what she's telling the servants. If Jesus is telling you to do this, just trust him. Just believe that whatever he tells you, doesn't matter how crazy, I'll explain it while I say this. Doesn't matter how crazy the idea might be, what Jesus is telling you, just trust him. Do whatever he tells you to do. Mary here knew what Jesus wants from us. Our surrender, our trust, and our faith. We have to hand it over so that Jesus can do what he does best. Restore, rebuild, and renew. Do whatever he tells you. We are the new wine. And he can and will take our lives and turn them into new wine. But we have to surrender our lives to Jesus. James 1 verse 22 says, and it applies that true followers of Jesus are good hearers and doers. Because it says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourself. Do what it says. Can't just listen and hear the word. You actually have to actually participate in the word and have action about what it means. But let's continue on. John 2 verse 6 and 10 goes on to say, nearby stood six stone jars, the kind used by the Jews for ceremonial washing, each holding from 20 to 30 gallons. Jesus said to the servants, fill the jars with water. So they filled them to the brim. Then he told them, now draw some out and take it to the master of the banquet. They did so, and the master of the banquet tasted the water that had been turned into wine. He did not realize where it had come from, though. The servant who had drawn the water knew. Then he called the bridegroom aside and said, everyone brings out the choice wine first, and then cheaper wine after the guests have had too much to drink. But you have saved the best till now. What's fascinating about verse 6 is that it's the least likely source of an answered promise. John just sort of slips it in. By the way, there were six stone jars there for Jewish rites of purification, each holding 20 to 30 gallons. Now, here's more of the incompleteness that we get. And I'll touch on this now. But coming back to speaking about when do whatever he tells you to do. Can you imagine? Just put yourself in one of the servants' frame of mind. Just imagine Jesus goes and he says, okay, I see these six stone jars. They're made for ceremonial cleaning. Can you just, put some water in there, fill it up, and then just take the first cup and go to the master of the banquet Can you imagine being at that time? You're like, huh? Are you for real right now? That's for washing, not for drinking, and especially not wine. But here's the incredible thing. The servants does what Jesus tells them to do. If the servants didn't believe and trust, can I tell you, there would be no wine. Because it's only from them taking the cup and taking it to the master that it actually becomes the wine. And so the trust is involved in this. Now, carrying on with the incompleteness and the inadequacies of life and the situations that we find. And I love about Hebrew numbers. And I want to teach you about this. We talk about, you know, different numbers and the importance of numbers in the Bible. And again, I don't believe that those numbers are there by accident. When it speaks about six, remember how many jars were there? Okay, that's like, it's not a trick question, I promise you. How many stone jars were there? Six. Okay, so let me teach you something. Okay, so number seven speaks about completeness. Because creation, everything was done. On day seven, it was finished. It means it was complete. It was perfect. Number seven also speaks about God. Okay? Number six speaks about man. Why? Because it means man is incomplete, inadequate. Because number six is before seven. Six is when man was created. So it means inadequacy, means incomplete. We are not God. That's why we're not seven. We are six. So again, how many stone jars were there? Six. So it speaks about a spiritual incompleteness already. Because there wasn't seven jars. There wasn't five jars that speaks about grace. It speaks about six jars. Because it speaks about incompleteness. So it speaks about that there was already a situation that was incomplete. Because Jesus sees the incompleteness. But that's the thing I love about Jesus. He takes something that is incomplete, that is spiritually incomplete. Six stone jars. And what does he tell the servants? He doesn't tell them, okay, I see this incomplete, so just fill it up halfway. Go read it for yourself. What did they do? They fill it up to the brim. So whatever your incompleteness is, believe it. When Jesus fills you up, he doesn't do half measures. He doesn't go, okay, I'm just going to fill up till here. You have to do the rest. No. Our God does full measure, overflowing. He's like, fill it up to the brim. That's why it's so important to study the Word of God. Because you read the numbers and you can skip it. And you can be like, ah, that's sick, blah, whatever. But Jesus knew what this means. Because in this moment, remember now, the first inadequacy, the first incompleteness was the wine ran out. Then Jesus go to six stone jars. Okay? Six being incomplete. But I'm going to go even deeper now. Because there's an incompleteness of these jars in itself, not just the number six. Because also these jars themselves, and the Bible speaks about it, it says these jars speaks about the purification process. It was supposed to be the ceremonial cleansing, ceremonial cleaning. Now, here's the thing about it, because whenever they had to go do something, whenever they had to go eat, you know, okay, who's here? Our parents here. You know when you tell your child, you know, we're going to be eating this now, did you wash your hands? Okay, do you do that? Okay, you don't have to answer if you don't do that. But oftentimes we will say to our child, you know, go wash your hands. Did you clean your hands? Johnny, I see that your hands are still dirty. Yes, Mom. Go wash it properly. So that's basically what they talk about, ceremonial cleansing. They talk about washing their hands, washing before they go out, because it speaks about cleansing themselves. But here's the great thing. You know those adverts when they talk about soap? And you see the fine print, it says it kills 99.9% germs. What happens to the 0.1%? See, even they know, advertisers know, that they can't do 100%. So even in this ceremonial cleansing, in those stone jars, even when they go and clean themselves, it means that there has to be a repetitive process. Because they're going to have to go again to clean themselves. And it's not going to be 99% clean. They're going to have to go again and clean themselves. So it speaks about incompleteness, inadequacy, because it isn't adequate enough to just do one and for all. You have to go there over and over and over again to clean yourself. So Jesus says to the servants, fill the jars up with the water. It is fascinating that this is the first point in the story we see anything complete. Because Jesus fills it to the brim. So it means it is full. It is complete. We see anything done to the fullest level possible when Jesus enters. And we read the detail that the servants filled it up to the brim. There's not any room left for water. It is completely filled up. Some of you are here this morning in a desperate, painful circumstance. Maybe you are in a desperate inadequacy, feeling incomplete. You can't live a moment of your life without cropping up in your mind. Even if you try to forget about it for a little while, they pop back up. Inadequacies and incompleteness that raises the question from Satan himself. Are you enough? Do you have enough? Do you have what it takes? How many words have we heard over our lives being spoken like that? You cannot do this. You are not ready. You are not complete. You're broken. You cannot get this job. You're not experienced enough. You cannot get a child. You're barren. You cannot get money because you're poor. How many of incompleteness have been spoken over your life? How many of inadequacies have you believed over your life? When people have spoken this over you, you're like, yeah, that's my identity. Maybe I am not complete. Maybe I am inadequate. Maybe I cannot be a mom. Maybe I cannot be a dad. Maybe I cannot be, you know, having a house. Maybe I cannot have a car. Maybe I cannot have a business. How many of you have been there? Don't show hands, but you know who you are. Maybe you've been there in that place for a long time. Satan attacks you with these questions. He wants you to doubt. That's his very tool that he uses. He uses doubt. He wants you to worry about your inadequacies and somehow disqualify yourself from life, from peace, from security, and from satisfaction. See, here's the cliffhanger. And the band can start making their way to the stage. You probably have in your mind an action, a plan for success. You probably have in your mind, if I could accomplish this, if I can just continue doing that and do it well enough, if I can just get this promotion, if I can just get this relationship, if I can just lay out the steps up to my success, then I could be complete. I could be whole. You may be able to fill up the jars in your own life. But let me just say this and understand this. You might be able to fill the jars with water, but you'll not be able to turn it into wine. Because only Jesus can turn water into wine. You may say, I don't really need Jesus right now because I can fill my own jars. I have a good career. I have success. I have family. I have this. Can I tell you? That is just water-based. But do you want really for God to move in your life? You have to trust him. You have to say, Lord, that is my jars. Fill it up to the brim and turn it into wine. And see what God can do. See what God can do. You can't make it and turn it into wine on your own. That's what Jesus came to do. Your remedy, whatever you think it is, or maybe of some of you, your story is not that you haven't been able to reach the heights that you wanted to reach. the success plan of your life. Maybe your story is that you already arrived and you look around and you realize that you're still inadequate. Because there's always a new height that you need to accomplish. Always a new car, always a new house, a new this, a new that. And every time you get there, there's something new that you need to do. You always feel incomplete. And dare I just say this? Maybe for some of us it's a drug addiction. Let me just say this. Maybe you feel complete for that moment. If I just do this for a while, I'll feel complete. If I just grab the bottle for a while, I'll feel complete. All my sorrows will be away. All my struggle will be away. If I just sleep with this man or this woman, I'll be okay. Because that will make me complete. Can I tell you that is a lie from the devil? Because that will never make you complete. It's just a temporary solution to a long-term problem. You don't need that. Because that is just water. What we need is new wine. And can I tell you? You will only really, really be complete when you have Jesus in your life. That's what makes your life complete. The whole message of grace tells us that we are not adequate. We're not enough. We have inadequacies. We are broken people. We live in a situation where we just don't have enough to get the job done. To get what we need. What we do will never be enough. In John 2 verse 8, we read, and he said to them, now draw out some and take it to the master of the feast. So they took it. When the master of the feast tasted the water and now become wine and did not know where it came from, though the servants who had drawn the water knew, the master of the feast called the bridegroom and said to him, everyone serves the good wine first. When people have drunk freely, then the poor wine. But you have kept the good wine until now. He's not going to give us something else. He's going to give us himself. As you look to him, as you look to him in faith, as you turn from your sins, as you recognize that he is your Lord and your Savior, but look beyond your incompleteness and inadequacies, so that you can look to him and the new wine that he gives. He covers our shame. He covers our guilt. He takes it on himself. He provides for us what we cannot provide for ourselves. Here's the incredible thing about this story. In verse 9, it speaks about this. The master of the banquet credits the groom for the good wine. Did the groom do anything? The groom did nothing. Jesus performed the miracle. But yet, the master of the banquet credits the groom. So Jesus covers our shame. We just have to rest in his peace. Rest in his promise. And he goes to his father and he says, I died for that child. I died for that man. I died for that woman. So credit them with good wine. Credit them with the best wine. Can I tell you? You don't have to do anything. You just have to trust and obey. You just have to say, Jesus, here I am. Fill me to the brim. Here I am, Lord. Save my life. Here I am. Thank you for your grace. Thank you that I no longer have to live with shame. Thank you, Lord God, that I no longer have to live with guilt. Thank you, Lord God, that I don't have to live with this brokenness. Because I was broken, but now I'm made whole. I was sick, but now I am healed. But you have kept the good wine until now. Here's the incredible thing. The inferior wine prepared the way for the superior wine. The inferior wine prepared the way for the superior wine. They had to drink the inferior wine first before they can get the superior wine. And I love the way that God does this, because he saves the best for last. You might have not received your miracle yet. You might have not had your breakthrough yet. But do not give up. Do not allow the enemy to say that you are not good enough. You will not get your breakthrough. You will not receive your miracle. Can I tell you, your miracle might be one jar away. One jar away from you receiving your miracle. But if you give up, you will not see it. Why? Because you are just still in the old wine. But there's new wine waiting for you. New wine that is speaking about your breakthrough, speaking about the miraculous power of Jesus. So stay put. Have the faith. Have the trust. Knowing that God has got the best wine in store for you. There's no one and no thing that is better quality than Jesus. He is the best taste. Psalm 34 verse 8 says, "Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good." The best wine, the best honey, the best bread. There is no higher quality than Jesus. There is no better taste than Jesus. You might be on drugs, you might be on other nonsense, but can I tell you, when you turn to Jesus, He is far more better quality than anything of this world. And when you taste Jesus, you don't want to go back to your old ways, to the old wine. Why? Because Jesus tastes better. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good. You have to ask yourself this question. Am I going to continue living, feeling incomplete and inadequate in my life? Listening to the voices of the enemy? Or am I going to allow Jesus to fill me up to the brim? And allow His mercy and His grace to fill me up afresh and anew. I want to ask you to stand this morning. I pray this word really ministered to you this morning about not just new wine, but speaking about inferior quality, the inadequacies, the incompleteness, and what it means for us to be complete in Jesus. And many of us have been grasping at straws, grasping at anything that can resemble something of being complete or made complete. But this morning, you can only be made complete in Jesus. Your jars might be empty, your wine might be empty. Your bicycle might have some missing parts. But this morning, Jesus wants to make you full. He wants to renew and refresh you. And I don't know if there's anybody here this morning that needs to give their life to Jesus this morning to say, "Lord, I don't want to live with this brokenness and this hurt, this far-off country where I'm not with You and You don't live in me. I need You to fill me up. Fill me up to the fullest." And no matter where you are, even for those who are watching online, where Jesus is speaking to you, you can only be made complete in Jesus. No man, no woman, no program, no business, nothing of this world can make you as complete as Jesus does. Maybe you are on your empty tank right now and you need to be filled up. And I want to give you this opportunity. Those who want to give their lives to Jesus for the first time, you've never given your life to Jesus, this is your first time that you actually acknowledging that Jesus is your Lord and Savior, I want to give you that opportunity just now. And even for those who want to maybe rededicate their lives to Jesus, maybe some things happened in your life. Maybe you came to the place where you were full, where you were filled up. But just like at that wedding at Cana, On the third day, it ran out. Maybe your third day was something that happened. A brokenness, a hurt. Somebody that treated you unwell. A relationship that didn't work out. A business that failed, and that you blame God. You said, God, but I trusted you, and you failed me. And all of a sudden, you pulled away from God. Can I tell you, we pull away from God. God doesn't pull away from us. And He's calling His children back home. And if that is you, I want you just to lift your hands this morning. That's you. That's you. Don't feel embarrassed. Don't feel ashamed. There's a few people in the back. This section is just keeping an eye out for that. Jesus wants to give you everything of Himself to you. He wants to give you new wine, but it comes with a surrender. Comes from giving Him your brokenness, your hurt, your pain, your unforgiveness, your hurt, everything, and saying, Lord Jesus, this is what I have, and I'm giving it to you. Make me whole, make me new. So I want you to repeat after me, and always going to say this prayer. Those who have lifted their hands up, just continue just to stand there. Somebody will come today with a red card. It's just a salvation card. But we're all going to repeat this prayer. Thank you, Father, for your Son Jesus, that died on the cross for all of my sins, past, present, and future. I make you my Lord and my Savior. I turn away from my old wine, and I welcome in the new wine. Fill me up to the brim. In Jesus' name, amen.